They dangle the right to vote in front of you to make you think that you're a participant in power. But they kept the real power in the hands of the wealthy elite, more and more so over the years.
Hey, gang. So, if you're a truth seeker like I am, and I'm thinking like most everyone that's watching this video is, you're going to like this channel, Think For Yourself. I met Megan for the first time on Michelle's live stream last week, and just really a very sharp thinker, very respectful, well-spoken, and I think you're going to like her channel. She deals more with true crime and really kind of exposing some areas that you might not have thought about, but I'm personally somewhat addicted to these court cases. And have been for a few years, so she brings a very interesting side and view to what's going on. So I recommend her, and the reason I bring her up is she put in a post a video from this channel, Truth Versus the Agenda. The video that she put in her post was about the Smith-Mundt Act, and we all know what that's about. If you don't, it's worth researching. But this particular channel is no longer putting up videos that I can tell. It's been like 6 years, but I still want to give them credit. But they've got a few really interesting videos out there. And this particular one I want to show you on military psychological operations. So here we go. Love y'all. Air Force Research. How to use social media to control people like drones. You want to stop this one and read on your own as you have time, but I'm going to read some of the highlights. Facebook isn't the only organization conducting research into how attitudes are affected by social media. The Department of Defense has invested millions of dollars over the past few years investigating social media, social networks, and how information spreads across them. While Facebook and Cornell University researchers manipulated what individuals saw in their social media streams, military-funded research, including projects funded by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agencies, DARPA, Social Media and Strategic Communications, SMISC program, has looked primarily into how messages from influential members of social networks propagate. DARPA launched its SMISC program in 2011 to examine ways social networks could be used for propaganda and what broadly falls under the euphemistic title of Military Information Support Operations, MISO, formerly known as Psychological Operations. Today's global information environment is complex, rapidly changing, and requires integrated and synchronized application of the instruments of national power to ensure responsiveness to national goals and objectives. In the current operational environment, effective influence is gained by unity of efforts in what we say and do and how well we understand the conditions, target audiences, and operational environment. Within the military and informational instruments of national power, the Department of Defense is a key component of a broader United States government communications strategy. To be effective, all DoD communications efforts must inherently support the credibility, veracity, and legitimacy of USG activities. Military information support operations play an important role in DoD communications efforts through the planned use of directed programs specifically designed to support USG and DoD activities and policies. MISO are planned operations to convey selected information and indicators to foreign audiences and influence their emotions, motives, objective reasoning, and ultimately the behavior of foreign governments, organizations, groups, and individuals in a manner favorable to the originator's objectives. Military information support professionals follow a deliberate process that aligns commanders' objectives with an analysis of the environment, select relevant TAs, develop focused, culturally and environmentally attuned messages and actions, employ sophisticated media delivery means, and produce observable, measurable, behavioral responses. The employment of MIS units is governed by explicit legal authorities that direct and determine how their capability is utilized. This legal foundation establishes MISO as a communications means and allows their integration with those strategies that apply the instruments of national power. Leaders and planners interpret relevant laws and policies to conduct MISO in any situation or environment, internationally and domestically. CNO supports MIS forces with dissemination assets, including interactive internet activities and the capabilities to deny or degrade an adversary's ability to access, report, process, or disseminate information. These capabilities support MIS by providing access to digital media within the information environment to reach intended targets and denying TA information that does not support objectives. Military information support operations and military deception. MIS forces provide the JFC the ability to reduce the allocation of forces and resources required to deceive the adversary and facilitate mission accomplishment. MISO create and reinforce actions that are executed to deliberately mislead adversary military decision makers about U.S. military capabilities, intentions, and operations. MILDEC operations that integrate MIS units' targeting input provide the JFC with the ability to influence the adversary to take specific actions or inactions, giving the joint force an advantage. MISO support to MILDEC operations must be carefully considered by the commander and staff, weighing the likely benefits of a deception operation against a potential short and long-term loss of credibility with the media and local and regional audiences. Military information support operations and public affairs. 1. MISO are used to influence the attitudes, opinions, and behavior of foreign TAs in a manner favorable to U.S. objectives. 2. Military PA forces plan, coordinate, and synchronize public information, command information, and community engagement activities and resources to support the commander's operational objectives. Through timely dissemination of factual information to international and domestic audiences, PA puts operational actions in context, facilitates the development of informed perceptions about military operations among information consumers, and undermines adversarial information efforts. And for the record, my TikTok channel 1212 Watchman is no longer available because of showing videos like the next two I'm going to show you that expose America, in my opinion, as a communistic, at best socialistic country that is completely an oligarchy, a coin with two sides owned by the same person.
True characteristics of the Communist Party are to be found not so much in its theories as in its methods of organization. Keep in mind that they are applying a new concept of warfare, the concept of conquering a country from within. How do you conquer a country from within? You conquer it by capturing the organizations that operate inside the country. A labor union, a farm organization or newspaper guild, a teachers association, a political club, a government agency, etc., are considered as power centers. The sum total of these organizations is the sum total of power. The Communist Party organizes inside of these organizations, group by group. To fight them effectively, one has to do the same thing in reverse. Mere resolution passing can't cope with that sort of an enemy. Major Janos Fures, Chief of Special Activities, the unit responsible for disinformation work in the Hungarian service, he told me they preferred that an item for disinformation should have some real basis in fact. But if I can produce a good idea that does not have any fact, send it in anyway. Truth is not important if the idea is good. Just send it in, they'll make it look truthful, then get it published in some little newspaper somewhere. And after that, we will hand it out, get it republished everywhere. Who can prove it is not true? End quote. Now this too, we must know about our opponent if we are not to be fools and suffer defeat in every battle.
Oh, America isn't a democracy. America is an oligarchy. It's a plutocracy. It's ruled by the rich. Of the rich, by the rich, and for the rich. Democracy in America is just a smokescreen. It's a charade that they perform every election cycle just to pacify you, to make you believe that you have some stake in the system. But I mean, look at the reality. For roughly the first 100 years of American so-called democracy, only white male property owners could vote. The so-called land of the free was built on the exclusion of the vast majority of its people from the democratic process. This gradually expanded to include all white males and then theoretically black males, but not in practice, in theory. Eventually, they had to grant the vote to women and Native Americans. Imagine that. The indigenous people of that land were the last to be given the right to vote in that land. What kind of democracy is that? But they never wanted power in the hands of the people. As the franchise of voting expanded to include those who were not white male property owners, the real power moved further and further away from the democratic process. They dangled the right to vote in front of you to make you think that you're a participant in power. But they kept the real power in the hands of the wealthy elite, more and more so over the years. As the right to vote expanded, the relevance of the vote contracted. I said no one ever intended for power to be in the hands of the people, and it never has been. I mean, just look at how money controls politics in America today. The Supreme Court's decision on the Citizens United case opened the floodgates for corporate money in elections. Billionaires and corporations pour millions and millions of dollars into political campaigns, drowning out the voices of ordinary people, of the whole electorate. They're hiring candidates, they're writing laws, they're purchasing policies that serve their interests. This isn't democracy, it's oligarchy. When a handful of wealthy individuals can dictate policy and sway elections, obviously democracy doesn't exist. Politicians just do a tour of duty in government to prove their loyalty to their funders before moving to highly paid positions in the private sector, working then for the same people that they worked for all along. You know, every time they do a tax cut, who benefits? The richest 1% will receive the lion's share of that, while the rest of the people have to make up the difference. Whatever they don't take from the rich, they take from you. Instead of taking from the 1% who own and control more wealth than the rest of the 99%, they take it from you. And somehow you still think you live in a democracy. No. The democracy they have is the one they always intended to have, which is one in which only the rich and the owners of the society have any say. You have the right to free speech only because no one listens to you. And where has this led? Where has this system of yours led? Well, it's led to the only place that it ever could lead. It's led to the creation of an unaccountable oligarchical elite who don't see you as anything but entries in their accounting books, either as assets that they own or liabilities that they need to eliminate. And through globalization, this nation within a nation, because that's all the rich are, just a nation within a nation, they became a global nation. They became an empire. And America is just one of the territories under their sovereignty. Oh, they colonized you. America became a colonized country, conquered by their very own monopolistic plutocratic elites. And they're subjugating you and the entire collective West the same way that you colonized and subjugated our countries. They've created global institutions, imperial institutions like BlackRock, like Vanguard, like State Street. That's why I talk about the owners and controllers of global financialized capital. The owners organized institutions of control. And that's what BlackRock is. BlackRock is like the Ministry of Imperial Expansion. It's like the colonial office of the old British Empire. And we in the Global South, in the Muslim world, recognize it as such. Nobody likes BlackRock. Nobody likes the fact that we have to deal with this now, this predatory monster, that you made, that your system created, because you created the most insane wealth gap in history, and you created financialized wealth accumulation. You know, you brag about how brilliant your economy is, how your brilliant economy has created more billionaires than any other economy, as if that's a sign of economic health, not economic deformation. You know, you don't say that about anything else. For anything else, such kind of a disproportion like that is seen as ugly and unnatural, like if someone has abnormally large teeth or something, or like those guys who lift weights in the gym but only work upper body muscles, so they have little spindly chicken legs. Your economy is a mutant. The point of a healthy economy is not to produce huge disparity, but you brag about it. Even as you hate BlackRock, while you made BlackRock, you created this class, you created this nation of parasitic wealth hoarders and the institutions they use to organize their economic power. The institutions of the feudal elite. The institutions that they use to consolidate and expand their control over everything. Well, nobody likes it, but you did it. You created this super predator. And now we all have to deal with it. And of course, BlackRock, State Street, and Vanguard, it's not the first time you did something like this. The East India Company, the United Fruit Company, they were earlier versions of these types of institutions, these institutions of economic imperialism. And of course, for all of these institutions, the current ones and the previous ones, their main business has always been war and pillage. Because the fact is, you've never really come up with another way to make money. All your technology is only made possible by vicious exploitation, slavery, and violence. You know, it bewilders me. Every argument that Westerners make to substantiate their claim that their so-called civilization is superior, every argument is materialistic. We have nice things. We invented all the technology of the modern world and so on. You don't realize that when you make that argument to the Global South, well, we're living in the background where all that technology comes from. It comes from our minerals, our rare earths, our mines, our ravaged environments, and our subjugated labor. We're living in the part of the Apple logo where the bite is. So that doesn't impress anyone in Africa or Asia or Latin America. You have nice stuff. Yeah, we know how you got it. We know how you got it. And it wasn't by brilliance, it was by brutality. It was then and it is now. So you should really stop using that argument. It's self-incriminating. So we don't have the option, and we know we don't have the option to ignore BlackRock or pretend it doesn't exist. We have to deal with it. We have to deal with the reality of it. And the reality is, that those billionaires you brag about creating have eaten you down to the bone, and now they're coming our way. They have completely captured your governments and all of the powers at the disposal of your governments. We can look around and see what's happening in the world. We can see what's happening in Europe, how BlackRock and the World Economic Forum are humiliating and sabotaging that whole continent, weakening the countries of Europe while simultaneously driving them into war. Your inspirational billionaires are leading Europe to the slaughter. It's really quite remarkable. You know, they got rich by colonizing us, and now they're colonizing you. And if they can, they'll come back again and pillage us all over again. But we have experience now. Now we know better how to strategize and how to contain the threat your OCGFC posed to us. And we know how the power dynamics have changed in the world. That's why countries like Saudi Arabia, the UAE, and Malaysia are initiating deals with BlackRock, partnerships with BlackRock. We know the risk, of course we do. But like I said, we can't safely ignore them either. By voluntarily giving them a stake in our economies, we disincentivize open hostility and aggression. And we can set the terms, we can define the relationship, and we can fix the limits to ensure, inshallah, mutual benefit. Look, there isn't a part of the Muslim world that is not under threat. There isn't a part of the Muslim world today that they don't already have a prepared pretext for invasion and violent coercion, from the Sahel to Southeast Asia, and obviously the Middle East. All of the pretexts are there for violent disruption and destabilization. If it weren't for the partnerships between BlackRock and Saudi Arabia and the UAE and the Gulf and Malaysia and so on, I don't think that there's any reason to believe that there wouldn't already be a region-wide war in West Asia, in the Middle East. But those deals have given the OCGFC a reason to prefer stability. It's those deals, in my opinion, it's because of those strategic partnerships that Israel is getting more and more isolated. And it's why Zionism is fast becoming obsolete. There's no doubt in my mind that if our countries completely cut off access to institutions like BlackRock, if we completely shut them out, as many are inclined to do, and quite understandably, but I have no doubt that if we were to do that, then the neocons in Washington would have all the OCGFC backing they need to launch multiple wars and campaigns of violence across the global south. Again, nobody likes it. And everyone is fully aware that these people are vicious predators and cannot be trusted. But it's precisely because they are this way that we have to deal with them.
It's just like the mafia. Giving them a cut of your revenues potentially keeps your shop from being burnt to the ground. Because you see, the OCGFC, your OCGFC, want to come over here.
Your BlackRocks and your Vanguards, I mean, for Vanguard, the name gives it away. They want to come over here, but our systems are not like yours over there. I've talked about this many times. Our systems, our authority structures are not like yours. We have our own OCGFC. We have our own elites. We have our own domestic owners and controllers, kings and sultans and emirs and tribal chiefs and mukhtars and what have you, especially in the richest countries, our richest countries, like the Gulf states. And they're connected. Those authority figures are connected, often even by family ties, to the population. They have a heritage of power and control, and they rule both the public and the private sector. And they have a memory of colonization, and that memory informs their strategies now. Because they don't want to get co-opted again. They don't want to get subordinated again. They know your tricks, and they know your traps and your triggers, and they know your criminal intentions. And most importantly, they know that you're coming over here, let's be honest, because there's nowhere left for you to go. And that means that they have some bargaining power, and that's what they're doing. Our liberation from colonization is not going to happen by means of some dramatic revolution, but by a careful, meticulous succession of maneuvers, just like a prison escape, moving at just the right moment, just the right distance. And once we get out of the prison compound, there's a minefield we have to navigate through. It's going to happen by a series of trade-offs, with each trade-off resulting in more sovereignty and more independence than the last. And every door that we pass through will close behind us, until eventually the prison guards and the prisoners have completely traded places. I believe that that's what our countries, the Muslim countries, the BRICS nations, and so on, I believe that that's what they're doing. And they're doing it masterfully, in my opinion.
Understand, it's not necessary for people to believe this information in order to weaken democratic institutions. You just have to flood a country's public square with enough raw sewage. You just have to raise enough questions, spread enough dirt, plant enough conspiracy theorizing that citizens no longer know what to believe. Once they lose trust in their leaders, in mainstream media, in political institutions, in each other, in the possibility of truth, the game's won.
It's your birthday, we gon' party like it's your birthday. And you know we don't give a f- it's like your birthday. If I need a club, bottle full of bug, my mind got what you need. If you need to fill the bars, I'm in the habit of sex, I ain't into making love. So come give me a hug, you're getting rough. You can find me in the club,